Welcome to the study of dynamics of motion. In the previous episodes, we learned about the relationship between force and motion, the parameters of motion, and Newton's first and second law of motion. In this episode, we will examine the action and reaction of forces as embodied in Newton's third law of motion. The law states that to every action, there is always an equal and opposite reaction. Till now, we have been examining the concept of force and motion in the context of a single object. Often, we come across situations where objects come in contact with one another with a considerable force within a fraction of a second, resulting into a collision. Such kind of a contact is referred to as impact.
Impacts are commonplace. A shot put creates an impact when it hits the ground. There is an impact when a ball is struck by a batsman. Likewise, the cue ball creates an impact when it collides with other balls. These kinds of impacts result from impulsive forces, which are implicit in Newton's second law of motion. An impulsive force can be defined as the force that acts for a time that is short compared to the time of the event. As the impulsive force acts for a very short time, it cannot be measured directly. Therefore, it is measured by determining the change in momentum. The game of billiards is a good example to understand the principle of impulsive force. Here, the cue ball hits the target ball with a certain amount of force, say F. At the contact point, the force gets transferred from the cue ball to the target ball within a small period of time, say delta T. This transfer of force creates a change in the momentum of the target ball, which can be measured as delta P. As per Newton's second law of motion, the change in momentum, delta P, is the product of force F and time of contact, delta T. Therefore, the change in momentum, that is, delta P equals F into delta T, is the impulsive force. If the contact time is increased, the effect of impact will decrease considerably. This can be observed in the game of cricket. When a fielder stretches his palms in the path of the ball, he is likely to suffer an injury as a large force of the ball gets transferred to his palms in a very short contact time. But if he prolongs the time of contact by drawing his palms along the path of the ball, the impact will be less and he will not drop the catch. The consequences of some impact will be quite devastating. Our Earth has witnessed several instances of impacts in its history. One such impact is that of the meteor that struck at Arizona in the US some 50,000 years ago, creating a gigantic crater which was 570 feet deep and 14,000 feet in diameter. In the game of billiards too, the phenomenon of impact can be witnessed when the cue ball strikes the target ball in a very short period. As the cue ball impacts, its entire momentum is transferred to the target ball, making it move in the direction of the force applied by the cue ball. At other instances, a different phenomenon can be observed. Upon contact, the cue ball and the target ball move in opposite directions. Such reactions can be noticed in several situations. The force of the cue ball is the active force, and the force of the target ball is the reactive force. The active force of the cue ball makes the target ball move in one direction, while the reactive force of the target ball acting on the cue ball makes it move in the opposite direction.
Such instances of objects contacting each other and moving in opposite directions are at the center of Newton's third law of motion. The law states that for every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction. A large number of devices work on the principle of the third law of motion.
In rotating sprinklers, there is no mechanical device to rotate the nozzles. Instead, it is the action and reaction of forces that make the sprinkler rotate. While the active force makes water jet out of the nozzles, the reactive force of the water jet pushes the nozzles in the opposite direction, making the sprinkler rotate. Not just simple sprinklers, but rockets too work on the principle of action and reaction. The active force of the burnt fuel escaping from the rocket vent creates an equal and opposite reactive force to provide the thrust needed to propel the rocket on its path.
The three laws of motion which we have dealt so far can be studied in the mechanical system of spring balance used to determine the weight of objects.
When not in use, the pointer rests at zero. It continues to rest at that point until it is made to change that position by the application of an external force, such as a 1 kilogram weight. The external force of the weight makes the pointer move in the direction of the force applied. This movement is as per Newton's first law of motion, which states that a body continues to be in a state of rest or in a state of uniform motion in a straight line unless it is compelled to change that state by external forces. Thus, Newton's first law gives the definition of force. In the spring balance, the principle of the second law of motion can also be observed. The force required to move the pointer downwards is generated by the force of gravity acting on the mass of 1 kilogram. As a result of the gravity force, the pointer moves downwards with a changing velocity, leading to change in momentum of the pointer. The momentum so produced in the pointer is proportional to the gravity force of 1 kilogram force acting on it. This is all about the second law of motion, which states that the rate of change of momentum of bodies is proportional to the applied force and takes place in the direction in which the force acts.
The principle of the third law of motion can also be observed in the spring balance. When the weight is suspended, the pointer moves up and down the scale before coming to rest. The downward swing is due to the active force of the weight, and the upward swing is due to reactive force of the spring caused by the weight. When the active and reactive forces get balanced, the pointer comes to rest.
This, in fact, is what the third law of motion states, that for every action, there is always an equal and opposite reaction.
Each of the three laws is set to serve one objective. The first law defines force as an external agency that changes or tends to change the state of rest or of uniform motion of a body in a straight line. The second law provides for the measurement of force in terms of the rate of change of momentum, which is a vector quantity. The third law specifies the action and reaction properties which are inherent in all forces whenever they come into play. In addition, the third law, in combination with the second law, indicates the principle of the conservation of momentum.
Momentum always gets conserved. For instance, when the bullet is not fired, the momentum of the gun, PG, and the bullet, PB, is zero. PG plus PB equals zero. when the bullet gets fired, according to the third law of Newton. The gun exerts a force on the bullet, FG. And the bullet, in turn, exerts a force, minus FB, of the same magnitude on the gun, but in an opposite direction. These forces obviously act for the same small length of time, delta T. By Newton's second law, the momentum acquired by the bullet and gun are PB equals FB into delta T. PG equals minus FG into delta T. Since the action and reaction are simultaneous in a very short time, delta T gets cancelled. Therefore, the momentum acquired by the bullet is equal to the product of the mass and velocity of the bullet. PB equals MB into VB, where MB is the mass of the bullet and VB the velocity of the bullet. And the momentum acquired by the gun, minus PG, is equal to MG into minus VG, where PG is the momentum acquired by the gun, MG is the mass of the gun, and minus VG is the velocity of the gun. The total momentum when the bullet gets fired is MB into VB plus MG into VG, which is equal to zero.
This implies that the total momentum before and after the firing remains constant at zero. This kind of action and reaction, where the momentum of the bodies in a system get conserved, has yielded the law of conservation of momentum. The law of conservation of momentum states that when two or more bodies interact with one another, their total momentum remains constant, provided no external forces are acting.
This can be clearly illustrated with the game of caroms. When the striker hits the formation of coins, the momentum of the striker gets completely transferred to the coins, resulting in their motion. Thus, the total momentum before and after the strike gets conserved and remains constant, provided no external forces act on it.
The principle of conservation of momentum, like the three laws of motion, is in action everywhere. Examine such situations and explain how the laws are operating in them. This will enhance your understanding of the Newton's law of motion.
Besides your own textbooks, read the books suggested here. Principles of Physics by N. Subramaniam and Bridge Lal, published by S. Chand & Co. Limited, New Delhi, 1990. Physics Textbook by Arvind Kumar, B.K. Sharma, P.C. Jain and others, published by the National Council of Educational Research and Training, New Delhi, 2002. Pradeep's Fundamental Physics by K.L. Gomba and K.L. Gogia, published by Pradeep Publications, Jalandhar, 2003. Engineering Mechanics by S. Timoshenko and D.H. Young, published by McGraw-Hill, New Delhi, 1956. The questions for you to answer are: define impulsive force and impact. Describe various situations of impact in real life. Define the third law of motion. Describe active and reactive forces with suitable examples. Define the law of conservation of momentum and explain how Newton's second and third law coexist to conserve momentum. If you have any doubts to clarify, or if you wish to watch the unit again, write to the director, Consortium for Educational Communication, NSC Campus, Aruna Asaf Ali Marg, New Delhi, 110067, or email us at cec@del12.vsnl.net.in. You can also write to the Director, Educational Multimedia Research Center, University of Calicut, Calicut University, PO, 673-635. Email ID is emmrccalicut@yahoo.co.in.